Welcome to LACNET's March Patient Education Seminar here at Cedars-Sinai. We have a wonderful program for you and a wonderful line of presenters today. We'll be focusing on carcinoid syndrome and the new drug for carcinoid syndrome called Zermelo. So without further ado, let's introduce our first speaker, Dr. Dohad. He's the medical director here for aortic diseases at Cedars-Sinai. So without further ado, here is Dr. Dohad.
So my role in management of carcinoid is relatively small, but I do see a lot of carcinoid patients because they refer to me mostly from the liver and the oncology services. And we have an unusual and unique collection of carcinoid patients here at Cedars that we don't really see anywhere else in the community. And that's expected because the incidence of carcinoid is relatively low, and I'm sure the other speakers will actually allude to that. So I'm going to focus on a very narrow, kind of presentation that occurs, and the malady that follows carcinoid syndrome. So I'm going to talk about carcinoid in the heart. I just let you know I've never given a talk on carcinoid in the heart, so this is the first time I'm doing it. So I'm sure you guys already know this, but carcinoid is related to tryptophan metabolism within the cell, and depending on where the tumor is, the symptoms that the patients present with are different. So the tumor can be in the foregut, the midgut, or the hindgut. And from my purpose, from my kind of management perspective, the midgut is the place that there is the classic carcinoid syndrome where serotonin is released and causes all the issues that occur in the heart. So I'm kind of going to focus on that and not focus on the foregut or the hindgut, because if you look at this slide, it shows you where the foregut is and where the hindgut symptoms are, and the syndromes are very different, and they're very extremely variable in the foregut and the hindgut. But in the midgut, the release of serotonin gives a classic presentation of carcinoid syndrome. So the release of different chemicals from these carcinoid tumors is extremely variable, and there are dramatic numbers of particles that are released into your bloodstream. And all of them can cause different presentations, whether it be diarrhea or flushing or skin changes or cardiac issues. And our focus today, from my perspective, is serotonin. And all of these, although they play additional role in the entire presentation of the patient, the cardiac manifestations are related to the serotonin. So here is an example of what these chemicals do. So if you look at the kinins or the histamine, most released in the foregut, you get a lot of flushing and telangiectasias and discoloration of your skin, either because it becomes blue or black, and that's how patients may initially find that something is going on, or the diarrhea and cramping that's related to serotonin. But all the cardiac stuff that occurs, mostly in the right heart, occurs related to serotonin. So why right heart? So I'll show you a picture of the heart and how the blood from the inferior vena cava that goes through the liver and brings the portal vein blood into the heart first has to go through the right atrium and the right ventricle, and then goes through the lungs and deactivates the serotonin effect that doesn't occur on the left side. So unless you have a shunt, that means a connection between the right side and the left side, which is abnormal, that allows the admixing of blood from the right to the left, usually never get left-sided syndromes. It mostly affects the valves and the inner lining of the right side of the heart. And I'll show you some pictures of that. So here is the classic metabolic pathway of tryptophan metabolism. Most of us, in general, transmit about 10% of tryptophan down this pathway, create the serotonin that's stored as serotonin granules, and then serotonin is released in the blood, and that gets metabolized and excreted as 5-HIAA or hydroxyindole acetic acid in the urine, right? So that's the pathway. In carcinoid patients, this pathway is hyperaccelerated, and you produce a lot of serotonin, and hence the indole acetic acid in the urine. So that's kind of the fundamental of it. And as this serotonin goes through the right side of the heart, and here's a four-chamber view of the heart, and I'll show you a live echocardiogram image. Here's the left side, the left atrium, the left ventricle, the right ventricle, and the right atrium. Here's the inferior vena cava bringing blood from the bottom half of your body. Here's a superior vena cava that brings blood into the right atrium from the upper half of your body, right? And it mixes in the right atrium. And all the serotonin that pools now coats the inner lining of the tricuspid valve, which is this valve that separates the right atrium from the right ventricle. And then the blood gets pumped out from the right ventricle through the pulmonic system into the pulmonary arteries that goes into the lungs on each side, right? So the two valves that get affected are the pulmonic valve and the tricuspid valve. And I'll show you the lesions, what they look like. So this is similar. So here is a normal tricuspid pulmonic valve. Very nice three cusps with thin leaflets, almost transparent leaflets, right? And as your heart beats, these leaflets open and close, so the blood is moving towards us in this case, because as the blood goes backwards, it hits those cusps and cannot go backwards anymore. It stops the blood, and that's what we call a valve, right? And that's the tricuspid valve now affected by carcinoid, was this thickening of these valve leaflets because of fibrosis, right? Or collagen that's deposited in excessive amounts in the lining of that valve and causes this valve to become fixed. So it's not hypermobile like this thin valve, but it almost becomes fixed. And I'll show that to you in an echocardiographic image. So serotonin is probably the pathogenic agent that causes all these issues with the heart. And it's the metabolism associated with receptors and certain genes that then may cause exaggeration of that response within the heart itself, right? And this is known to us in a clinical sense also from patients who took fen-phen. So you may remember the story of diet agents like fen-phen and fenfluramine that may have the similar effect, but in that case, we see effects on both the left side as well as the right side, because that fenfluramine is a systemic drug that can cause plaque deposits on any of the valves. We see that mostly on the mitral valve, actually. So what is the clinical presentation of patients who have carcinoid-related heart disease? So the important thing to know is if you have the classic carcinoid syndrome, 50% of patients will have some cardiac manifestation. 20% of the patients will actually present with the original carcinoid syndrome with something going on with their heart, either they have palpitations, or they have fatigue, or they have shortness of breath. But in general, the cardiac manifestations are very delayed and they're very subtle. So unless your physician is asking you the right questions, you may not be able to tell the physician really what may be going on. But the most common thing that occurs is they feel fatigued and they feel that there's a loss of endurance that occurs. Only later, as the disease progresses, do they actually get, a fullness in the stomach because the liver gets enlarged, or actually gets swelling in the belly because you have ascites or fluid accumulate in your belly, or swelling in your legs, and that's at a much later stage. But the initial phase, it's mostly fatigue and loss of endurance. So, what about physical findings? And I think that this is something that's a clinical art that most of us cardiologists have actually lost. We do a lot of tests on our patients, and we don't really look at our patients' necks and auscultate as carefully as our predecessors did, who diagnosed almost everything with a stethoscope. I don't even have a stethoscope on me today, right? So, but the first thing that occurs is because these syndrome is only the right-sided syndrome, the veins in the neck become enlarged, what we call prominent jugular venous distension with pulsatile V waves. And that is probably the first sign that occurs in patients who have carcinoid-related or right-sided abnormalities. And it's a subtle finding, but it is something that you can pick up and first think of something going on the right side of the heart. Because although the tricuspid valve and the pulmonic valve become incompetent or have regurgitation, the murmur that occurs associated with it is very soft, because the pressures on the right side of the heart are soft, so they're not readily audible in the early stages. And only later on, when the patient becomes progressively decompensated, do you get the symptoms of edema, or swelling in the legs, or ascites, or swelling in your belly, or pulsatile hepatomegaly, where your liver becomes pulsatile because the tricuspid valve leak now goes directly into your liver and makes your liver pulsatile, right? So these are late phenomena, but the earliest phenomena you'll see is the V wave. What about blood tests? The blood test that we cardiologists measure a lot for heart failure management is something called a BNP level, or serum NT-proBNP levels. So when you measure that and follow patients who have carcinoid and heart disease, the proBNP levels generally will be elevated, more than 250 picograms. So when you have elevated proBNP levels, you know that the cardiac, the heart has already been affected substantially related to the carcinoid. So that is the most sensitive and the specific way to measure it. You could measure urinary levels of HIAA or chromogranin levels, but those are much less sensitive and specific. So the one blood test that I think points to heart manifestations of carcinoid is the BNP level. So let's go and look at the heart itself affected by carcinoid. And if you look at this valve, this is the tricuspid valve. Here is the same, the echocardiogram, which is a four-chamber image from the apex. Here the ultrasound beam is going from the left side of the chest. And here's the left ventricle, the left atrium, the right ventricle, and the right atrium, right? This is the right side of the heart. You can see the right side is actually bigger than the left side, and that's abnormal. The left side usually is about 0.1 bigger than the right side. So it's, the ratio is 0.9 to 1 from right to left. And you can see that this is much bigger. But most importantly, look at this valve. Look how hypermobile the mitral valve is. And this valve is fixed, whether it's systole or diastole, it remains completely fixed in one position. And what does that do? It allows the blood to leak back and to and fro. So if you look at this red beam going through, it accelerates because the valve is stenotic. That means it doesn't allow, it's like a constriction in the valve. And then on the backside, as the ventricle contracts, it causes leak backwards. And this is what we call tricuspid regurgitation, right? Which is a leaky valve in the across the tricuspid. So what do we do for, there are other things that we can do, MRI and CT scan, that incidentally may pick up plaque in the right side of the heart. But that's not a test that we do normally for management of carcinoid. But incidentally, if you were to have a CT scan or a CT angio, your radiologist may pick that up incidentally. But the way to diagnose this is purely the echocardiogram. So management, so initially it's just clinical assessment of the patient, measuring the proBNP level and what the symptoms are of the patient. The earliest therapy that we have from the cardiac perspective alone is diuretic therapy, which is basically a water pill that allows you to urinate excessive water that builds up in your heart. But that doesn't last for long. If your carcinoid remains untreated, you may progress to severe valve disease where surgical therapy becomes the mainstay of therapy. And we'll talk about that in a second. So what can we do for valves? So you have two valves that are involved, the tricuspid valve and the pulmonic valve. The pulmonic valve, in general, is not as important in maintaining hemodynamics as the tricuspid valve is. Nonetheless, if it becomes severely stenotic, then that becomes a problem. That means the valve becomes constricted so that blood cannot go through the pulmonic valve. If it's an incompetent pulmonic valve, it's not as much of a problem as if it's a stenotic pulmonic valve. So sometimes in the past, the surgeon used to just go and cut the leaflets out and not replace it with a new valve and just get rid of the valve. But now we have better bioprosthetic valves. That means we have valves that are made from bovine pericardium, which is a lining of a cow's heart. And those are stitched into these valve leaflets that last longer. And now most of the valve replacement, either the tricuspid valve or the pulmonic valve, is now done with these bioprosthetic valves. And as long as the primary therapy is aggressive and adequate, these valves will not degenerate like the native valves did. But if the primary therapy is not adequate, these replaced valves will also degenerate and become either leaky or tight. So what about the success of this surgery? So in the initial phases, the mortality was from Mayo Clinic was noted to be about 10%. But today, even if you look at our center, and Alfredo Trento is our cardiac surgeon, does most of these right-sided surgeries that I send patients to, our mortality is less than 5% right now. And as long as the other therapy is adequate, the outcome of these of all our patients is really good. And once their primary therapy and the primary carcinoid is treated, they generally do well from the cardiac standpoint because the right ventricle remodels, the valves remain competent, and they don't need our patients don't need anticoagulation for these bioprosthetic valves. So that's the reason why you don't put metallic valves on the right side anymore, because some of our carcinoid patients need recurrent surgery of different kinds. We don't want to take them in on and off blood thinners. So I'm going to stop there and you know, I'll take questions.
Our next presenter is a returning guest presenter, and it's Dr. Andrew Hendafar, and he'll be talking about carcinoid syndrome. Thank you.
Thanks for having me today. Very good timing for all of us. We have yet another approval for therapy in patients with neuroendocrine tumors. It's really been a monumental past couple of years, and I feel good that I always have something to talk about. It's not like I'm sitting up here twiddling my thumbs, so that's really nice. So, you know, now it's like this, it's so interesting about medicine and cancer therapy is that no one really cares about something until you have a medicine for it, which makes it very interesting in cancer care. And Dr. LaPuerta can probably confirm that, right? I mean, what is a disease? A disease is something that we can treat. And if we can't treat it, the disease is usually less interesting to providers and patients themselves. And so we've been taking care of carcinoid syndrome patients for quite some time. We've gotten to understand it, and we're just really happy that we have the opportunity to transmit this information now to the rest of the physicians and population. So people in here, I'm preaching to the choir, a lot of people here know what a carcinoid syndrome is. And it's a syndrome that basically is a description for the types of symptoms that you get from your neuroendocrine tumor when it secretes some bad guys into the blood. And those are the factors that Dr. Dohad mentioned. So what are the more common symptoms that we talk about is here, is the, it's kind of blurry, isn't it? Or is it just me? It's diarrhea, cramping. These are the problems that we deal with in the clinic that everybody here probably has to deal with as well. As Dr. Dohad mentioned, we get heart issues, and that's usually farther along in the disease course. And then if you're really smart and you're looking very carefully, sometimes you can find other symptoms that are much rarer. But when we talk about carcinoid syndrome, what we're usually talking about is diarrhea and flushing. And you can see here, this is a nice bar graph detailing that. And we got your top three covered today, so that's good. Now, although we're considered a rare disease and we all have the zebra gear, it's interesting that we're not really that rare, right? There's 100,000 cases a year. Which is interesting, isn't it? So what I would say is rare is that each of us probably has a unique disease presentation, a unique type of neuroendocrine tumor. This is a big group, this neuroendocrine system. It means lots of different things. This group here, colon and rectum, it's not that interesting, if you ask me. Lots of similarities between them, right? But this group, there's a lot of differences in the neuroendocrine system, and I think that's really important. And I would say those differences don't apply to these other groups. And one of those differences is the carcinoid syndrome, right? So where do neuroendocrine tumors come from? Again, this points to the what we call as heterogeneity of the disease. It comes from all the different organs. And there are some similarities, don't get me wrong. There are some things that bring all neuroendocrine tumor patients together. Some commonalities. One of those commonalities is symptoms from their disease, and it can be the carcinoid syndrome. Now, I think this is, from all the time I've spent treating neuroendocrine tumors, this is really one of the most important principles in management, and it's really unique to our disease. Colon cancer doesn't have this, pancreas doesn't have it, stomach, all the other GI tumors don't have it. That's two-pronged. One, we have to manage the tumor. Everybody knows how to do that. But just as importantly, we have to manage the syndrome. Not every cancer has a syndrome associated with it. So if you have the carcinoid syndrome, you have two problems. You have tumor problem that you have to control, and you have the syndrome that you have to control. If you ignore one of those two, then you're probably not doing as good of a job as you want to do. And the reason why it's so important to manage a syndrome is, as we discussed today, is that when left unchecked, it can have lots of problems. Both Dr. Dohad's going to talk about it. Dr. Wertheimer is going to talk about it. It can cause problems with your heart. It can cause other problems. Having multiple episodes of diarrhea today is not good. It's not, you know, you can't go to the movies. You can't really enjoy your life that well. It's a problem. So we have to take care of both. And what's difficult about carcinoid syndrome is that even with our best treatments, they work at first, and then they don't work as well as time goes on. And this is important. And that's why what we're talking about today is important. So here's a nice study looking at how many patients are controlled with somatostatin analog therapy in their first year. And you can see it starts off great, 90% control. And then when you get to 3 years, only 20% control. And that's what we see in the clinic. So today we're going to talk about something that's a great medicine, but it's hard to describe. It's called, even the name was hard until the new brand name, Xarelmo, is better. Good job. But telotrastat, ethyl. It's a peripherally acting serotonin synthesis inhibitor. We have an inhibitor of tryptophan hydroxylase, which helps us reduce serotonin production. Okay? And that reduces the amount of serotonin in the peripheral circulation. Now, I showed this one. This is an interesting slide. So this medicine was made with the intent to help the carcinoid syndrome. And Dr. Laporta, how long ago did you come up with this medicine?
It's been in development for about 10 years.
So about 10 years. So 10 years ago, we started with the mice. We go to the preclinical studies. It's amazing, isn't it? It takes 10 years. Phase one, phase two, and now we just completed and reported. Actually, we did that last few years, completed and reported the Telestar phase three trial, and now FDA approval. And I showed you this slide so you have an understanding of what it really takes to get these medications approved. You have the mouse models, you have the studies in humans, you have the dose finding, then you have the small phase twos where you look, and here we did a placebo control open label, and then you have the randomized controlled study at the end. So let's look at this study design. Please raise your hand if this doesn't make any sense. I'm happy to explain it. So in the Telestar study, there was three arms. One arm was placebo, one arm was the medicine at 250 milligrams three times a day, and one was 500 milligrams three times a day. This was done over a 12-week period of time. The primary measure, or the most important thing that we looked at, was bowel movement frequency. So that was agreed upon with the FDA, what we needed to show. We needed to show that there was an improvement there for this medicine to get improved. And then after 12 weeks, everybody was placed on the 500 milligrams three times a day dose. So this is important too. So all patients were required to be on somatostatin analog therapy at enrollment and continue it throughout the study period. So again, these pills are designed and supposed to be given with your somatostatin analog therapy, not by themselves, okay? So this is what we'd call adjunctive or an add-on. So one of the important things that we have to show when we do a research study is that everyone in the three arms were pretty similar to each other. And nowadays we have computer programs doing it. So whenever I show these types of tables, it's a waste of time because it's computer generated. So they're always, the three arms are always identical. So the computer, you know, takes a patient, and people ask me when they're on a study, like, why, doc, would you put me on placebo? That's a horrible thing to do to me. And I say, no, we don't. I don't do it. It's a very fair process. What happens is the information goes to a central place, it gets cataloged in a computer program, and then an arm spits out. So then a patient gets assigned based on some factors, and these are the factors. And they're all the same in the three arms. So let's talk about the key findings. This medicine, telotrastat, was able to improve the number of bowel movements that patients had at 12 weeks that was statistically significantly improved and met the primary endpoint. Here is a nice graph showing the improvement at both dose levels. Here's another graph showing the improvement. I like these waterfall plots here because they're pretty easy for me to describe. Here you see the yellow waterfalls showing you the diarrhea getting improved. And here on the blue one, you see the same thing. You see the diarrhea getting improved. Now, the placebo group did have some improvement, but not as much as telotrostat, not even close. And that might be why, I don't know if you have any ideas about that, but I might have some theories.
The question is why some patients would improve on placebo if they weren't getting any active treatment. Well, they were getting octreotide every 3 or 4 weeks, depending on what their physician was recommending. And we've seen some of you who have taken octreotide, you know that sometimes you get a good shot and sometimes you get a bad shot. We think some of these people who responded on placebo, they got a bad shot when they first screened for the trial. And so they had more bowel movements, maybe right. 5 or 6 a day when their normal was maybe 4. And then they had some good shots during the study, and so it seemed that over time that their bowel movement frequency had come down. I think that's why some people did well on placebo.
That's great. Now, how many patients here are on pancreatic enzyme supplementation? About half the room. Do you think that might have some contribution?
It could have some contribution, but we have looked at that, and we see evidence of efficacy from telotrostat ethyl in patients who have pancreatic enzymes and patients who do not have pancreatic enzymes. And the use seemed to be generally about the same among all the treatment groups.
Oh, it was the same amongst both groups? Okay. All right, thank you. Okay, so the phase 3 results show that more than 40% of the patients who received telotrostat responded, meaning they had an improvement in their bowel movements. There was a statistically significant reduction in the levels of 5-hydroxyanilic acid, or 5-HIAA as we know it in the clinic, which is good. The reduction in flushing and abdominal pain were greater with telotrostat than placebo. And there's a trend towards decreased use of rescue therapy, which I think is a great sign that the medicine's working. So in summary, excessive serotonin secretion is the hallmark of carcinoid syndrome. And telotrostat ethyl is a selective serotonin synthesis inhibitor. The phase 3 study reported robust data extending nearly a year, and it provides statistically significant and meaningful reductions in bowel movement frequency. And it's a promising new class of treatment for patients with this disease. And thank you so much for your attention.
Our next presenter is Dr. Jeffrey Wertheimer, and he is the Chief of Neuropsychology here at Cedars. So, welcome.
Thank you so much. So let me first extend my gratitude for the opportunity to talk to you as well. I think a question may come in of why is a neuropsychologist in this room, and how is this relevant to everyone in the room? So let me first start with the objectives. They're twofold. One is to understand why neuropsychology is in the room. So what is it that a neuropsychologist does, first and foremost, and how may it be relevant to carcinoid syndrome? And two, I want to introduce a recent study that we've been putting together called GRACE, Growing Resilience and Courage with Cancer. And I'll give you a little more details on that in a moment. But my disclaimer on the front end is this is like a tapas-style restaurant presentation. These are two sample platters of something that's really a large meal to digest. Maybe a poor choice of words in this case, but nonetheless, it's really important to realize I'm only going to give you a quick snippet, and then I can answer questions as we go forward. So neuropsychology, people understand what neuro is, brain. Some people understand what psychology is. And many think, oh, the psychologist, he's going to talk about how we're feeling today. Well, neuropsychology is a subspecialty, so we understand brain-behavior relations. So the organicity of the brain, the structures in the brain. And we also understand the mind and how that's relevant to human behavior. So we're a scientific discipline that looks at brain-behavior relations in addition to psychological well-being in the context of medical conditions. So brief, when we talk about brain-behavior relations, we assess cognition. What cognition is, we look at details related to intellectual functioning, achievement-oriented behaviors. Attention, concentration, executive functioning, that's like the head of a business, one that manages all the big decisions, manages complex tasks, and so on. Language, memory, visual perceptual processing, how do we process the world through vision, if you will. Sensory motor functioning, and then psychological and psychiatric profiles. That's a lot to do in an assessment period. What I want to highlight is through the assessment process, we're looking at both relative strengths as well as our challenges or deficits, impairments, if you will, and opportunities. Where do we go from here? So as a neuropsychologist, we're understanding the bigger picture. And let me pause. How many of you have heard of neuropsychological assessments before? Okay. Few, if very few, in many regards. So in this particular case, what I want to highlight with neuropsychology is where we get a bad rap because sometimes we have one patient for one day. Sometimes we test a patient for 6 to 8 hours. because we take brains for test drives. We understand the thoroughness of how they're functioning. In this case, though, I want to kind of go against the myth, if you will, or it's reality in some cases. We can do abbreviated batteries. We have what we call assessments where it's a clinical interview and then maybe an hour, hour and a half, 2 hours of formal psychometric testing. That's the testing that looks at brain functioning and psychological well-being. So should some of you undergo this, I thought I'd take the opportunity to tell you what you may experience. We have a clinical interview, and we assess cognition, again, and behavior, the psychological well-being. We look at both what we call objective test data. What does the test data tell us? But we also look at the qualitative experience, what's happening in the room, how the behavior may present itself beyond what test data can tell us. Then when we get all that data, we look at interpretation. That's where neuropsychologists comes in. And we make a better understanding about what is being presented to us. We have our impressions, we discuss prognosis, what this may portend for the future, and then recommendations, of course. And we bring in education to the patients, the treatment team as a whole, sometimes just your physician who referred you, and when it's appropriate, we bring in family or significant others that may help in the treatment process. And treatment's very important because we can address cognition, we can address psychiatric, and then we also look at general adjustments, pain-related factors that could affect thinking skills and emotional well-being, as well as sleep disturbance and so on. So we have a lot we tend to do for the medical community, but we're really an unknown service to a lot of providers. Again, how does this relate to individuals that have carcinoid syndrome? And I'm going to go there next. Since we're dealing with restaurants and food, I have sorbet moments in my presentation. That's to clean the palate before I make a transition. Okay, so I'm going to now shift gears and talk about why this is relevant to everyone in the room. It is relevant to cognition, it is relevant to emotional status, it is relevant to clinical research, and that just means educating ourselves in a more thorough way through empirically based approaches, scientific approaches, not hunches. Well, first start, how many of you have experienced word retrieval problems? I know what I want to say, but I can't say it. Okay. Anyone sometimes misplace the keys and say, oh my gosh, where did I put those keys? Okay, that's normal. I'm certified to say that. It's normal to lose things. It's normal to have retrieval problems. It's normal to all of a sudden feel overwhelmed when trying to manage multiple things at one time. The good news is we can also say that's partly appropriate to general life experience. We also can say that during the aging process, the older we get, the more vulnerable we are to these changes. But that's still what we call normal. Good news, we compare people and their cohorts over time. But when does it become abnormal? When that interference occurs in day-to-day experiences, when it's troubling, when it becomes what we call pathological, that means it's definitely intrusive upon day-to-day affairs, day-to-day activities. And neuropsychologists will categorize what's normal, what's not normal, and what do we do about that? So in this case, there's scant research, very little research out there as it relates to cognition and carcinoid syndrome, but there is research out there. This Dr. Chambers and his colleagues looked at this, and he found this. And why I like this study, it was a small sample, so we can't generalize to a larger group, but we can say, this is informative. We need to do more. But what he did, and this, I guess, his colleagues, they looked at the subjective report, just like everyone in here, subjective. Do you have problems with pulling out information? I think so. Do you have problems with their memory? A little bit. That's just my opinion. But then we have to look to the psychometric tests, the tests that we collect as neuropsychologists prove that objectively. And what we found were in individuals with carcinoid syndrome reported their own reports that they had more difficulties with verbal memory, memory for verbal information, memory with difficulty with attention, concentration, language, that word-finding problem, in addition to motor changes in language, slurred speech. Anyone knows when they're really fatigued, sometimes they kind of mumble a little bit more, you slur your speech a little more, that can be relevant. Memory for visual information, and then what we talk about, processing visual stimuli, what's before us. Now, with the objective findings, that was the self-report, the objective findings were definitely on the memory side for verbal information, memory for visual information as well. When it looked at language, it was more of a word retrieval challenge, that tip-of-the-tongue phenomenon, and then management of more complex tasks. I should mention this, all right. Those were all within normal limits. That means those were fine. What they did find for verbal memory, retrieval. It's that pulling out information that was a greater problem. It's like, I know we talked about it. I can't remember the details. Also, they found that memory for that processing of visual stimuli is more difficult as well. So honing in on two major domains in this particular study. They've confirmed, too, that basically they needed more research. So the same group, actually, different first author, okay, did a different study design. They said, let's not only look at people with carcinoid syndrome, let's have a comparison group. And that comparison group were, in this case, non-neuroendocrine liver metastases. So we had 36 individuals in the carcinoid syndrome group, and then you had 20 in the other group. And again, they looked at both what the subjective report was, as well as what the objective test results find. And then in this case, they found that people with carcinoid syndrome, they often perceive greater difficulties than their comparison group, in this case, and also the comparison to the normal population. But when we look at the objective tests again, what we tend to find is that there's a weakness with, they say, initiation. They look at processing speed difficulties, memory for visual information, and then that retrieval again, the verbal recall. I know it. I know we did that. I recall that, but I can't give you a lot of detail. It's hard to pull out. The take-home point for this group is that there are changes in cognition, and we're starting to focus on certain degrees of change and in what domains they're changing. We're still figuring out why, just a little bit of research, but it's important to note people are experiencing changes in cognition. And when we look at these other groups, in this case, the comparison group, the non-neuroendocrine liver metastases group, they found that, again, people with carcinoid syndrome objectively performed worse than that population. So there's something happening. We don't know what exactly, but there's something happening between these groups. What we're speculating in part is that sometimes there are metabolic changes, there are chemical changes that can occur and cause some cognitive inefficiency, as they call it, a difficulty with attention concentration, some problems with, again, aspects of memory and retrieval. I know in this case, we know that serotonin, which was discussed earlier, is changed. Now, that's serotonin in other parts of the body, not the brain, but serotonin is a neurochemical. It definitely can be impacted as well, and that's a big plausible explanation. There are changes in this chemical that's causing some disruption for this group. And then we know that some cancers can metastasize, can occur in the brain. And then psychiatric symptoms, if I'm very depressed or if I'm really anxious, it can impact my thinking skills. Pain as well, if I'm really in a lot of pain, it can actually interfere with the efficiency of my thought process. And if treatment effects, chemo, radiation, among many other medications, can impact cognition as well. So we have to think both what's directly related to brain, and we also think of what we call extraneous to organic brain pathology, in essence, something that's not related to brain change, but can indirectly affect or directly affect cognition that with factors outside of the brain. So there are psychiatric changes that can occur too. It's common, again, and these are through formal tests with neuropsychologists, that people are identifying these changes, feeling a little more irritable, a little more on edge. Some people define themselves a little more aggressive. Agitation, again, falls in that category. Sleep disturbance is also an issue. Okay, increased appetite can occur, headaches, motor restlessness, feeling a little fidgety, and then we have a reaction to this condition, which can manifest in feeling depressed, sad, blue, anxious, but not necessarily clinically elevated, but I'm feeling these symptoms. Just a pause. I'm going to shift gears. All right, coping and adjustment. How is that defined? Well, let me first pose a rhetorical question. Are we well equipped? I know I have audience that participate in our GRACE program, so this comes through that, but with that, we have to ask ourselves first and foremost, how are we adjusting? Do we perceive ourselves as adjusting well? Do we have the coping skills to manage this? As we know, if we have really intrusive symptoms that, you know, that impact our social skills, so you know what, I can't leave the house for too long because I could have disruption. That's affecting our social environment. If that happens, how am I adjusting to that? How am I coping to these medical conditions and their symptoms? So it's a rhetorical question, but I'll get there in a few minutes. So it's not uncommon when we have these medical conditions. This is generalizable. We have these psychological responses. We're in disbelief at first when we get the diagnosis. What does that mean? How do I process that? Sometimes we'll live in denial for a little bit. Or sometimes we have relief because now we understand. But sometimes we get experience of frustration. We feel depressed, sad, concerned. We have a sense of guilt, a little bit of grief, and so on. But often in the medical community, we highlight symptoms. What are we in our culture today? Our culture is a pathologically focused culture. How many of you would go to the doctor if you didn't have a symptom? That's what our culture does. We go to the doctor to get help to fix a problem. But how many of you go to a doctor and say, let me focus on how well I'm doing. Let me talk about my resilience, my determination. Is that integrated in your talks with your doctor? Not too often, because you're there for a focus. I want to focus on the problem I have here. Help me address that. But if we start addressing the strengths that we have and bring to the table in the context of our medical management, we realize that it could indeed have favorable outcomes on a medical condition. Showing you a brief example, when we're anxious, what's a common symptom? They're physical symptoms. Highly anxious individuals, we can get tremor. We can get shakiness. We can have bowel changes. We can have diarrhea. Again, anxiety, psychological distress can affect our physiological symptoms as well. So if we start identifying where we can address psychological well-being, we can actually help physical well-being, if not help with just our adjustment and reaction to these changes. Which takes me to this point. When it comes to understanding emotional well-being, there is the spectrum. There's disturbance that's clinically significant and we need to intervene. Either it's biological with chemical agents, medications, or through psychotherapy or some mental health professional. We have adjustment difficulties. This is very difficult for me. But it's not necessarily abnormal. It just means I'm having some struggling. I'm concerned. And then we have the appropriate response. Being scared or nervous about a new symptom, not surprising. That doesn't mean it's a problem. It just means something we should address or be aware of. So the question for us is to pathologize or not to pathologize. In that case, it may guide us down different paths. But what I want to focus on right now is a new term in our community. It's called GRACE, Growing Resilience and Courage with Cancer. I'm only going to spend a few minutes on it because it's really getting a lot of traction here. So Dr. Asher, he's a physical medicine rehabilitation doctor, a brilliant physiatrist, just a wonderful person. And when we came, I interviewed here 7 years ago at Cedars. He interviews one of the people that interviewed me. And he asked me if I know about logotherapy. Man's Search for Meaning is the title of a book where it's meaning-centered living. It's a new intervention. It's about understanding how do we focus on well-being, not just pathology. And what he wanted to do was identify a treatment for medical patients that's beyond medication. How do we affect the whole being, the whole person? Because that's not necessarily where we go in our culture. His issue was, very briefly, he gets 10 minutes with a patient, 15 minutes sometimes. That's not enough to create heal. It's enough to try to address a symptom, but he wanted to help with a broader healing process. So we put together this GRACE program under this premise. Existential processing. Man's Search for Meaning, again, is the title of a book by Viktor Frankl that really talks about when we suffer, do we have to suffer unnecessarily? In this case, we know that with people with medical populations, especially with cancer, we may have preoccupation with the future. What is the next doctor appointment going to do? When's my next medication? Okay, the past. Okay, do we live in the past for good or bad? Do we feel a disconnection from self, others, phenomenological worldviews, our ultimate meaning? Has the cancer or medical condition affected how we find meaning and purpose in our life? Crisis of meaning, do we find ourselves in what they call the existential vacuum? We're confused. We don't know what to do. I was working, I can't work anymore. My conditions change that. I used to go to these activities all the time. My hobbies have now changed. We lose sight of ourselves. So in this sense of needing to be in control, I don't know how many of you feel that issue. I'd love to be in control. My body is not telling me I'm in control right now. How do we address that? In this case, we created a curriculum. It took about 3 years to put together. We've had it in practice for 2 years. And it's a 6-session empirically anchored, that means science-proven, intervention. It's based off these tenets, and I'll go through this quickly, but the take-home point is it is psychotherapeutically oriented, but it's a wellness model. We have a physician, not just a psychologist, that's facilitating this. We also have a chaplain I neglected to mention. Bronwyn's our chaplain. She's marvelous because some of these are big spiritual questions for some, existential in nature. The intervention or cognitive behavioral therapy, that's a tool practice-based approach, but also there's a whole model on addressing well-being. Positive psychology, not focusing only on symptoms that we have, but all the strengths we possess that can then help us address these symptoms that we face in the challenge. And we use some readings, but it's a very creative environment, but it really taps into all these different mediums to address well-being. It's very thought-provoking. It's pretty heavy. It's pretty heady. But so far, we're finding almost, pretty much universally, there's an element of growth. Again, you don't have to have medication, we're going to try that, to find cures, yes, to address symptoms, yes, but are we healing in the process? Healing's a psychological construct. Can you heal in the face of medical conditions? Yes. It seems challenging, but that's where GRACE tends to go. So it's a 6-week curriculum. As you'll see, all of these are positive-based, insight and wisdom, week 1, hope and gratitude, week 2, that's cognitive behavioral therapy heavy, finding purpose and meaning in our journey, we can't dismiss the power of feeling connected with others, and also humor's medicinal. I don't know if many of you try it, but it's pretty powerful. Strength and courage and perseverance and blessings. So those are the themes, and I wanted to briefly give you a picture. What did we do? We did a pilot first, and we looked at individuals. There were 42 individuals that participated. This is about 6 to 8 per group over a series of about a year. And there were key constructs. One is spiritual well-being, not religion per se, as much as our perspective of connecting with something greater than ourselves. And what you see here, we also looked at depression, hopelessness, and elements of anxiety, both psychologically and physically somatic, I should say. And what we found were, on the spiritual well-being, lower scores, less psychologically ground, if you will. Higher scores mean more engaged with spiritual practice and spiritual perspectives. So as you can see here, the numbers went up from pre-assessment to post-assessment. Depression, hopelessness, and anxiety all went in the right direction. Higher scores are bad, meaning higher scores are elevated symptoms. Lower scores demonstrate that those symptoms are reduced. And again, what we would expect to find is that a psychological intervention would have a favorable outcome. On the somatic side, we didn't see a statistical significant change, but it's also not surprising. A lot of these individuals were active, you know, cancer individuals with stage 4 cancer, in this case advanced cancer. So a lot of them were still engaged in treatments that were medically related. Some were actively experiencing heavy physical symptoms, and GRACE isn't designed to treat all of those. And that's where we saw, not surprisingly, lack of statistical change. But we did see improvement again on psychological adjustment and spiritual well-being. Why is this so important again? People that tend to have better perspectives manage their well-being psychologically. They're more compliant with intervention. They actually make it to doctor's appointments more often. And physically, their subjective report is that they're feeling physically better. But again, that's perception. It's the power of the mind, which I'll talk about in just a minute. So after the pilot, we went into clinical trial phase. And what we did is we got some grant funding. We were awarded a certain amount of funds to help put together a trial with a specific population. In this case, it was looking at existential resiliency and, again, psychological well-being in individuals, women in this case, with metastatic breast cancer. So the purpose was to assess now more scientifically in a well-designed study a 6-week educational program designed to address spiritual and psychological well-being for this population. We used a waitlist control study. What that means is that we had individuals, everyone was assessed at baseline, and as Dr. Hendafar pointed out, we used a computer algorithm. They selected one group to participate and another group to wait. We can't deny individuals treatment if we know it's helpful. So what we did is we had individuals go through treatment. This group on a control group doesn't go through treatment, and then they go through treatment at a later date. So all we did is it was a wait list. So what we're saying here is everyone goes through treatment, depends on when. We have a group that undergoes treatment, we assess them before and after. We have a wait list control, we assess them before, and then we assess them after the same duration of time, but they didn't have any treatment. They went through standard care. And then they get to participate in treatment 1 month after, and we're tracking for, in this case, 12 months. So that's the design, and once again, what we're trying to do is grasp existential distress and psychological well-being. So I want to give you a taste of what GRACE is like, and actually Future Directions first. We actually submitted a grant for pancreatic population, and GRACE is growing. I've been asked by a few individuals to apply the same intervention for different medical populations. For example, ALS has been asking us to do this and so on. But we want to do this in a stepwise approach. We want to prove it's helpful. Everyone's saying it's helpful, but we need the evidence to support that. Then we're going to roll it out. So this is a brief introduction. So in week one, we even process what this means. This is, again, it's philosophical, but it's, again, very meaningful to a lot of people. So what does it mean to be healthy? How does one actually define health? Is it through your physical well-being, through your psychological well-being, or is it far greater than both of those? What does it mean to be whole? A lot of people feel as though part of them has been taken away. So how do we process these deeper constructs? And we can't dismiss the whole concept of resiliency. Resiliency is a big psychological construct. And we know in the literature, the more individuals perceive themselves as resilient, the more likely they're going to perceive increased quality of life, despite their physical well-being. I'd be remiss if I didn't introduce Viktor Frankl. Viktor Frankl is an individual. He's a Holocaust survivor. Why is this so important? It's not comparing individuals going through cancer to compare to those people that went through the Holocaust and were in concentration camps. But here's a physician. He was a neurologist and psychiatrist. And what he did is he had this belief, but then unfortunately he and his family went to this concentration camp. He was in it for 4 years. And we can only imagine. We can't even imagine. But here's a person that didn't know what the next day was going to be like, even if he was going to be alive, for 4 years. So in this case, he talked about his survival and what that meant to him, meaning-centered living. And then out of that came born a whole philosophy and treatment approach for well-being. And that's the premise. Again, he has this book called Man's Search for Meaning. The first part is his biography. The second part are tool-based approach to living well. And he has some brilliant quotes I'll share with you in a minute. But he said, unlike Freud, it's not about pleasure in the moment. No, it's about meaning in the moment. That's driving human behavior. We all know pleasure feels good. But pleasure goes away soon after the stimulus is gone. Meaning does not. Meaning-centered living has traction and carries weight. So this intervention carries a lot more impact on well-being than just, hey, how do we focus on the pleasures of life? It's a combination of living pleasurably, but identifying our meaning and purpose in life. So in this, we talk about this. Now, he talks about work, but more generally, there are three pillars for him. One is doing something significant. Another is enduring our difficult times, and more than enduring, finding the courage to persevere through them. And once you can identify that perseverance, again, you carry greater psychological well-being, and then love merely means a connection with other people. So these are his pillars of intervention. And he's facing this, and I think everyone in the room can appreciate that. When we're faced with a challenge that situations that we can't change, we're challenged to change ourselves. That's pretty big, because we're often faced with something we can't change. It's external, but how we can do is we can change our approach. Strength and Courage talks about coping styles. In this case, attitude is big. Our perception can be a really big driving force to well-being. We talk about instrumental coping, task-oriented strategies. We use distraction. Anyone distract themselves for coping? Many of us. We watch movies. We do what? We just go out. We just take our mind off things. Watch a sunset if we can. Self-soothing, comfort. Anyone to just sleep in bed a little longer? Anyone just want to take that nap? Sometimes we just want to let me just look at a painting and enjoy it. Let me just look at the sky or feel the breeze on my skin. Self-soothing techniques. And the last one's emotional preoccupation. Focusing on emotions is fine. When it's preoccupying and debilitating, now we need to take it to the next level of intervention. I just highlight this. Christopher Reeve is the pillar of attitude in many regards. Symbolically, strength, even after his spinal cord injury, he said, I'm a lucky man to be alive. And he had gratitude for the day, despite his physical decline. And Viktor Frankl has a brilliant quote. One of the last of the human freedoms is to choose one's attitude in any given circumstance, to choose one's own way. If we can get to managing that attitude, we'll find ourselves doing better than we were when we weren't managing that attitude. I can't skip this because someone referenced it beforehand. Sometimes our medical condition is at the focus of all our experience. But if we take that away, we still have these stressors. We talked about traffic getting here. Traffic stress, maybe just three of us. Okay, so in this case, I think there's a point that if we can manage, then we can't control that. That's back to some things we can't control except for our response to it. But nonetheless, if we can manage these stressors, it'll be very helpful too, beyond our medical condition. We get so caught up in how we're feeling about a medical condition, it really pervades or it's most of our life. But if we can address other aspects of our well-being, our perceived entire well-being can be improved. All right, I'm going to extend a few more. All right, but mindfulness is really important because it is about living this moment. Many of you focus on the future, next appointment. Who can tell me what the schedule is next week? Probably several of us. That's future-oriented. Totally fine until it's a preoccupation. In the past, I highlight this way. If I'm walking forward in life facing my past, I'm at risk, one, of stumbling and falling, or two, missing the moment. So the key is we can't focus on the past or the future too much. Helpful, but we have to live the power of now, and that's what this GRACE program tries to instill in all of us. Mastering perspective. I'm not doing this talk justice by going through this too quickly, but I will say this. It's not about putting rose-colored glasses on saying life's going to be okay, but it is harnessing the power of managing how we see things. And I'll give you this example. What do we see? A horse. Good. Is that all you see? Wait, that's impossible because it's only a horse, unless it's something else. Anyone? Got it? Okay, amphibian. Everyone see the frog? Good, we can move on. Sometimes it's hard unless we change perspective. Now we can see it. And for those of you that are perceptually challenged, sometimes we're here. The eyes, which is the nose, the eyes of the horse, which is, again, the leg, and so on. So it's, again, we're changing perspective. And my point of showing this is sometimes we can do it by ourselves. Sometimes it takes a group. It takes a peer. It takes someone else to help modify perspective. Either way, life isn't an illusion, but life does have the opportunity to see things differently, to modify perspective, to be more adaptive. Similarly, the power of thought can take you down divergent paths. When we say, I forgot to take my medication, oh, are you kidding me? What did I just do? I took myself down one path versus, yeah, it's not a big deal. Let me just take it now. Unless it's too close to another dosage, now I ruin my day. Just by forgetting our medications, we've now affected our entire day. Perception is very powerful. But the key, though, is this distorted. Sometimes we have detours. Sometimes we find ourselves going down paths that are not psychologically therapeutic. How can we stay not on the straight and narrow, but navigate the challenges of detours? This is a very simple model we use, oversimplified. We have a situation, an automatic thought, and a feeling. If I hit every red light on my way to work, I might have a quick response. And I won't use any descriptives here. You just know what I'm thinking. All right, so in that regard, my first situation is I'm hitting lots of red lights. My first thought, I'm going to be late for my meeting. My feeling, I'm anxious. My alternative thought, this is a reminder. In the big picture, 5 years from now, am I going to remember this red light? you know what, it's a chance to slow down, reflect, be there. I'm still anxious, but I'm not a 10 out of 10. I'm now a 4 out of 10. So we can modify our feelings to affect our experience. Henry David Thoreau, I'm a big fan. He has the longest run-on sentences I've ever met. But bottom line is he has this great, great quote, "A single footstep will not make a path on the earth, so a single thought will not make a pathway in the mind. To make a deep physical path, we walk again and again. To make a deep mental path, we must think over and over the kind of thoughts we wish to dominate our lives." Hugely important. I could be negative over and over again, I'm debuilding that groove. I could change my perspective and be more adaptive over and over. Now, what was hard is now automatic. We could call that neuroplasticity from biology side, but also from a psychological, which is his reference. We can control the self-talk, and if we do it, practice it enough, we can modify our well-being favorably. All too often, we live in the red. Just where we are. Symptom-focused. Okay. How often, and I had to challenge everyone in the room, do we engage in the purple? Do we find ourselves in positive emotions? Do we live there? Do we find ourselves engaging and getting lost in the moment? Do we find ourselves connecting with others? Using humor. FedEx won't deliver it if you didn't order it. But you can go find it. You can find it online. You can look for something humorous, even if it's related to your medical experience. How do we bring humor into it? Gratitude is very powerful. If you're grateful in a moment, you're not fearful, you're not angry, you're not upset, because you're grateful. So if you can hang on to the gratitude, it has lasting effects, accomplishments, and meaning and purpose. If you can check one of these bubbles each day, you're in the right direction. I'd say, can we do more than just one domain? Summary for here, taken points, psychological health has a strong relationship with perceived quality of life, and it also helps facilitate greater medical and physical well-being if we can manage the psychological battles we're facing too. Catchy phrase, where the attention goes, the emotion flows. It's there. Where you're focused is where your mind's going to go. Okay? Present-centered living, meaning-centered living can be very valuable. One would argue that's the whole purpose, that's the whole point. And again, although this may feel like an individual journey, I think everyone in this room can appreciate, someone gets it. It might not feel like everyone, but we're not alone. There are many people. Dr. Ohab pointed out, I think many too, there's symptoms that are unique to a lot of us too. Dr. Handafar, you brought this up too, unique to us. But there's a collective experience, and how do we learn from one another? How do we find each other, help each other become more adaptive in our responses? So the last slide, Viktor Frankl, again, a man of many quotes. Between stimulus and response, there's a space, and in that space is our power to choose our response. In our response lies our growth and our freedom. And the beauty is, if you miss that space the first time and your response came too quickly, there's a response, there's a space right after that. And then yet another space, then another space. We pause, and we choose our response. And with that, that can help facilitate greater physical, psychological, spiritual well-being in many regards. So just thank you, and I include you, Dr. Ho, Doha, I don't mind, on behalf of all of us. Thanks for your time, and I appreciate the attention.
Our next presenter is joining us all the way from New York, just to be here. He is the Chief Medical Officer of Lexicon Pharmaceuticals, and now we welcome Dr. Pablo Lapuerta.
Thank you very much. You helped me escape from the snowstorm, so I'm very excited to be here. I'm also excited to be in Los Angeles because I spent 5 years of my life here. And it's where I met my wife, and I have some in-laws in Los Angeles. I was a professor of internal medicine at the University of Southern California in the early 90s until 1996. It was 1996 that I entered the pharmaceutical industry and became deeply involved in the conduct of clinical studies. I thought what I could do today is, without showing really any slides, is just talk a little bit about the last 10 years and what it's been for the development of telotrastat ethyl and why it took so long for telotrastat ethyl to come to market. I've been involved in 6 years of the effort. I joined Lexicon Pharmaceuticals 6 years ago, and the program was still in its early stages, and we had a lot of challenges, and we're very fortunate that we were able to meet them and very proud that telotrastat ethyl was recently approved by the FDA. So the story starts around 2006 and 2007, and Lexicon was developing drugs in the laboratory. They hadn't entered human trials yet, at least not for healthy volunteers with telotrastat ethyl or patients with carcinoid syndrome. But there was a compound that was telotrastat ethyl in the laboratory, and we began speaking to experts in the field. Could this help patients with carcinoid syndrome? And they encouraged us to go forward and to take telotrastat ethyl into clinic. You saw Dr. Hendifar present three phases of research. Well, phase one is the first one, and it's often done with healthy volunteers. It's done with healthy volunteers because you have to make sure that your drug is safe enough to be tested in patients with carcinoid syndrome or with other conditions. The healthy volunteer study, they tend to be small, somewhere between, say, 20 and 80 individuals, depending on what you want to achieve. And you often just give just one dose and stop for many of the volunteers. And you just see if there's any short-term reaction. And then after you get some confidence that there's no short-term problem, you treat them for about 2 weeks, but only 2 weeks, being very careful. And you use a whole range of doses because you have no idea what the doses are going to be yet for your study in carcinoid syndrome. That took about a year and a half to do, to have all the data analyzed and to have studies in healthy volunteers. And that occurred around 2008. So in 2009, it seemed that we were ready to study telotrastat in patients. And what we learned from the healthy volunteers, one of the main things is that probably the best way to give telotrastat ethyl was 3 times a day. We saw that in the body of the volunteers. It would last for about 6 hours. A little bit more than that. And 3 times a day seemed to be the right amount. We also learned what dose we should try in clinical trials. And that 500 milligrams 3 times a day, as Dr. Hendifar described, probably would be the maximum. That if you went to higher doses, you might have stomach troubles or problems actually with diarrhea. So phase one went fairly well, and we started phase two. We started phase two around 2009. And phase two, we studied 4 different doses and placebo. And you don't have the luxury of having a big enough program to study so many doses when you're really making your commitment to show the efficacy and safety of a product. But if you have a small study, only about 30 days of treatment or 12 weeks of treatment, well then you can do an exploration of different doses. And in phase two, we got a sense that the drug was doing what it should do, was bringing down production of serotonin. There was some evidence, although it wasn't that robust. We only had 23 patients in one of our phase two studies. But we saw that among those patients, some were reporting symptom improvement. It did seem that both a low dose and a high dose could work. So that gave us the ability to design the phase three program that Dr. Hendifar shared with you. One of the most important reasons why this is all going step by step is safety. And in our phase two program, there was a woman who was hospitalized for nausea and vomiting. And we didn't know if that was really related to the drug or not. As part of carcinoid syndrome, she had many episodes of nausea and vomiting before. But during the study, she had an episode that was a little bit more severe than before. And we thought, well, we'll have to be very careful with this. So while phase two patients did very well, we really needed to have a large phase three program and to see if problems with nausea and vomiting were going to be common or rare. So we designed the program that Dr. Hendifar shared with you. It was 135 patients, the largest study ever done in carcinoid syndrome, and the first placebo-controlled study to ever succeed in the evaluation of carcinoid syndrome. Now that started around 2013. We had the first patient enrolled. So phase two took us 2 years to evaluate 23 patients in one study and 15 in another. We were going very slowly, step by step, dose by dose. Now we had to face with us a challenge of recruiting 135 people in a rare orphan condition. It was quite a challenge. And it took us about 2 more years to do. We were able to do it a bit faster because we participated in we had a lot of sites participate. We had sites participate on the East Coast, the West Coast, Spain, France, Germany, Italy, the Netherlands, and the United Kingdom, and Australia. But another reason is we had gained enough confidence in phase two that we could make it easier for patients to get into a phase three program. In phase two, we had people check labs twice a week we were so concerned about safety. We were not going to allow someone to have a serious safety problem on our watch. We saw the results were good enough, we could relax on that. And as a matter of fact, we reduced the frequency of visits to after the first 12 weeks, you only needed a visit about every 8 to 12 weeks after that. And some of those visits we allowed to be done at home. We'd have a nurse go to your home, and she could draw the labs and do an initial assessment. So with an easier program that offered drug for longer and having more sites on board, that's why we were able to do phase 3 to recruit all the patients in just over 2 years. So that took us to 2015. There was something else that we did that I think is very relevant to speaking about the GRACE program. A wonderful talk about the GRACE program. At the end of phase 2, I presented some of the results to the scientific community, and a patient came up to me. And he said, I was a patient in that trial. And he said, look, I think you've done a fair job describing things, but this drug really affected my life. And I realized that we had to capture the patient voice in a better way. Phase 2, we just had a checkbox. Do you have symptom relief, yes or no? That's totally inadequate. And you can see that by appreciating all the dimensions of the way illness affects your life. So he inspired me that what we would do in phase 3 that we hadn't done is we would interview patients. And we interviewed about 36 patients, about 36 patients in phase 3. And we had an outside expert do this, right? To preserve confidentiality, I didn't speak to any of the patients. They spoke to an independent expert who knows a lot about how illness affects well-being. Neither the patients knew what they were taking, nor the interviewers. And so we figured we could present to the FDA a package that had lots of numbers, like numbers you've seen in graphs and charts, but it also would have a collection of 36 statements from patients about what they experienced during the clinical trial. So it takes us to now to the end of 2015. We've enrolled all the subjects. They've been treated for at least 12 weeks on placebo or one of two doses of telotrostat ethyl. And a good set of them had interviewed and spoken to an expert about how carcinoid syndrome was affecting their life and how the clinical trial experience was affecting their life. And we unblinded the results. We were finally ready that we could have a statistician tell us who was on what medication. And the results were successful. And when I saw the results, the very first thing I looked to was not efficacy, it was safety. Right? Patients had been hospitalized. Patients had carcinoid syndrome. I was concerned. We didn't see a lot of hospitalization due to nausea and vomiting, but would there be a problem with hospitalization? We saw that during the 12 weeks in carcinoid syndrome among 135 people, 5 of them had passed away. And we knew that, but we didn't know what treatments they were on. Turns out most of those were on placebo. And none of the deaths were related to, I guess I should say the lesson from the deaths. Lesson from the deaths was that carcinoid syndrome is a serious health issue and it has to be controlled. It has to be controlled effectively. So we were very reassured when we saw that there was no imbalance in deaths. We looked at hospitalizations next. No imbalance in hospitalizations. So we saw some efficacy. We saw adequate safety that could help us prepare a filing for the FDA. And then we had these interviews. When I started reading the transcripts, they were very moving. Patients had suffered so much with this condition. And it meant so much to them to have control. We had a report written by an expert who didn't know what the results of the study were. And that's okay, because it was all about how is this syndrome affecting your life and how does controlling it affect your life. And her conclusion was not about the drug, it was about the disease. The conclusion was that carcinoid syndrome was limiting people's lives emotionally, socially, and physically. A lot like some of the struggles described in the GRACE presentation. And that controlling it, carcinoid syndrome, would have a very positive impact on patients' lives. So the expert's conclusion was a conclusion that wasn't about treatment. I think any effective treatment can do this. But that effective control of carcinoid syndrome can make people feel better, can make them more socially active, it could make them more physically active, and in a way that they would notice and appreciate. So once I saw that, with the safety head, we had the numbers that we had, I was very optimistic. And I told people publicly, we have a lot of work to do, because now we have to give a package to the Food and Drug Administration. But I saw the elements of safety and efficacy and the patient voice that would support approval. So we're still in 2015, and it didn't get approved until 2 weeks ago. And that's because we were at the end of 2015, and the FDA needed even more safety data. The FDA appropriately requests safety data far beyond 12 weeks. We needed to collect more data, and we were targeting the specific number of patients that were necessary with safety experience to contribute a complete filing package. And that, because of that, we were not able to submit a filing until March of 2016. And in those studies have continued, long-term telotrastat ethyl being given to patients who participated. They're still on. And now the longest a patient has been on telotrastat ethyl is 6 years, still in our study. We put that package together for the FDA, submitted it in March of 2017. I'm sorry, March of 2016. And now the FDA had to go through everything. And they had a dossier that is not measured in the thousands of pages or the tens of thousands of pages, but in the hundreds of thousands of pages. We may have had over 1,000 pages per patient. If you consider all the laboratory results, all the assessments, all the times, all the events that happened to the patient. And we had a lot of questions from the FDA, like there was a question about pancreatic enzymes. Did that seem to affect the drug? Right? So we were in a 9-month or 10-month process with the FDA to go answering those questions with them and to give them the time to review. And a lot of the discussion ends up being really about how to write a label that is available for physicians and patients so that you know how to describe the drug effectively. And you don't just say, oh, the drug succeeded in a clinical study. We talked to the FDA, what advice do we give to pregnant women? What advice do we give on elderly patients? What advice do we give on patients taking other drugs at the same time? And so that's why that whole process of preparing a filing and having it evaluated took I guess it was 11 months with the FDA. We're very pleased. February 28th was the day of approval. That was Rare Disease Day, so it was very good timing. And I'd love to work with the other speakers in answering any questions that you may have of telotrastat ethyl, its clinical development program, or any of the other things we've spoken about today.
So we have kind of speakers go on the light. That would be awesome.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. LaPreta. We will open up to generalized questions right now.
I apologize if I misunderstood one of the slides, but I believe it showed that telotrastat reduced symptoms in about, it was north of 40% of patients. Is that correct?
Yes. The slide was about the proportion of patients who achieved at least a 30% reduction in bowel movement frequency.
Then my question is, I'm assuming that, that telotrastat does reduce serotonin in just about anyone. So if only 40% receive the kinds of benefits, what does that difference tell us in the connection between serotonin production and carcinoid syndrome?
Yeah, I can help. So, you know, diarrhea when you have carcinoid disease can be multifactorial. Not all your bowel movements will be from the serotonin production. So, you know, when Dr. LaPorte and his team goes into a clinical trial, they have to figure out, you know, by decreasing or improving bowel movements, what percentage do we need to do that? What's meaningful? You know, is one bowel movement a day meaningful? Is it two? Like, what's that number, that magic number that makes sense? In this case, it was 30% improvement. So that was the reasoning going into the study. It wasn't like that's what they came on the back end and said, okay, this is the number we're going to arbitrarily pick. So that 30% was the, you know, the measure that we that was used. And it's a significant difference, and it's meaningful. So that's why they picked that. Now, you're right. Not no matter what you do for carcinoid syndrome, you know, you might still have a few bowel movements a day, and that might be from surgery, that might be from other medications, that might be from other issues. Yeah, but it's a good question.
If I could add to that, it's something we discussed with the FDA. And one of the things that the FDA did with us is they worked with us to put together a product label that shows information across a whole range of response. So if you go to the product label, which you can access at www.fda.gov, you can do a search under drugs at FDA, and then search under telotrostat or Zermelo with an X. You'll see a section of the label that has the totality of the data on response, from a reduction of 6 bowel movements a day to a reduction of 0, right? And so you'll see 40% approximately achieving a certain threshold of benefit, but you'll see others achieving other thresholds. So that I think it's more than 40% experience an increase in, I should say, a reduction in bowel movement frequency. If you actually look at that curve, it tells you that 90% of patients on Zermelo experienced at least some reduction. It was on the order of 40% where the reduction was of the magnitude that we had pre-specified for the agency.
I had one other question that's on also about Zermelo. You laid out a very good chronology ending on February 28th, but I submit to you that's not the final step. I received a prescription for Zermelo and discovered to my chagrin that it is not in Medicare's formulary, and therefore most insurance companies, mine included, are charging, my copay for 28 days would be $2,100. When do you expect that might be corrected, or is there anything we can do about that?
I would like actually another person from Lexicon here to speak about that.
Yes, so Linda. great question, and we have some information that we can share with you today, so if you just want to see Charisse in the back, we can give you that information around our access programs, and we have some great programs in place to help patients, both commercial and Medicare.
Any other questions?
What's the difference between a bad shot and a good shot?
I am glad you asked that question because I needed to explain it, and I realized I didn't say what the difference was. Octreotide is given to patients often about once every 4 weeks, sometimes once every 3 or 2. It just depends on the situation. It's a long-acting shot. And for it to work effectively, it has to reach the deep muscle. And sometimes with the shot doesn't reach the muscle. The drug is deposited in fat instead of muscle. And so if you have a miss that way, well, that's what would be a bad shot. And you don't get the symptom relief when that happens because you're not absorbing the octreotide well. So depending on the nurse, depending on the experience, depending on the situation, some patients every once in a while will have a bad shot of octreotide and not get relief for that timing interval.
So octreotide and lanreotide, would you ask patients to go from one to the next to see if either if octreotide is ceasing to work, would you expect someone to go on to another drug like lanreotide before starting this? How would you sequence it, in other words?
I think that really depends up to the physician. And the one thing that we tried to do for our clinical program to provide information to physicians is that we allowed patients to be on either octreotide or lanreotide. And so patients on octreotide or lanreotide who entered the study had similar degrees of benefit in terms of differences between treatment and placebo. But some physicians may want to try a switch to lanreotide from octreotide or vice versa before considering another medication.
Hi, I'm Tina Ban. I'm the clinical practice nurse for the carcinoid neuroendocrine tumor program here. I give between 3,000 and 4,000 shots a year of either octreotide, lanreotide, or pasireotide. In your study, were all of the patients that receiving somatostatin analog therapy, were they only receiving octreotide, or were they receiving octreotide and or lanreotide?
Most of them were receiving octreotide, and there were several, I think it was around 30, were receiving lanreotide. So it was 135 people, I believe it was around 98 on octreotide and 37 on lanreotide. Forgive me if I'm a little off by one or two numbers there.
Okay.
No one was receiving pasreotide in the Telestar study.
Okay.
And maybe you could tell people about the shots, since you've given so many.
As you said, it depends on the anatomy and a lot of things. The medication, both medications, are designed to sit as a lump in your tissue and be slowly dissolved over 28 to 30 days. Some days patients experience pain if you're having a lot of stress, a lot of anxiety, a lot of other things going on in your life. The days that my patients come in calm, they usually don't have any pain. The days that my patients come in stressed out from spending 4.5 hours on the 405 trying to get here, they experience more pain. Or you've had to lay flat on your back in your scans forever trying to get your CT and your MRI and things like that. I can't explain the pain difference. I try to do the same thing every time to make it as normal as possible for you. But yes, some patients experience pain, some don't. We use the pain ease spray as needed.
So thank you, Dr. LaPareta, Dr. Wertheimer, for joining us. A reminder, our next meeting will be at UCLA Tuesday, April 11th, and we'll be focusing on the caregiver and patient perspective. So we hope to see you there. Have a great day. Thank you.